Welcome. I want to introduce the organizers and sponsors of this event before we introduce the debaters. First off, I want to thank Every Nation Campus for letting us use this facility tonight. That was very gracious of them, and they passed around a flyer about one of their upcoming events, so I encourage you to check that out. This event is made possible by the generosity of the Arthur N. Roop Foundation. The Arthur N. Roop Foundation is dedicated to achieving positive social change by shining the light of truth on critical and controversial issues. It pursues this mission through the support of scholarly studies, education, research, public debates like this one, and by disseminating the results via a variety of media to all segments of the public. My name is Rachel Georgeson, and I'm a regional director with the Intercollegiate Studies Institute, the event sponsor. ISI is a nonprofit, nonpartisan education organization in Delaware, and it seeks to steep college students in an education focused on the Western tradition, one that many don't receive on their college campuses. We have student programs, and we publish books in the areas of politics, philosophy, and economics, and we act as a forum and a community for everyone on the political right. If you are a student, I encourage you to check out our website at isi.org. The three student programs I recommend to every student I meet are ISI conferences, paid student membership, and ISI societies. Our next conference is in April, and there's still time to sign up on our website. It's April 24th through 26th in Casper, Wyoming. It'll be about 50 students and a handful of professors. They'll gather to hear lectures and panels on the topic of philosophy against ideology. All on-site expenses are paid, and we do have travel stipends to make it affordable for students. And our conferences are truly an incredible intellectual experience, unlike any other, so I encourage you to look into it. Secondly, paid student membership is a fairly new program we have for students that are really passionate about ISI, and it basically gives them greater access to all of our programs. And there's a flyer at your seat about that if you're interested. And finally, if you want to get involved in ISI in this local area, we have an ISI society at ASU, which is why we're having this event tonight. So I want to introduce Richard Moorhead, the society president, who will be introducing the speakers. If you have questions about ISI, please contact me after this. And if you have questions about the society at ASU, you can talk to Richard. So without further ado, Richard Moorhead.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm so glad to see you all here tonight, and I'm definitely excited for what should be a very thought-provoking discussion. Our speakers on the topic of resolved religion for America, religion is bad for America, are Jay Richards of the Catholic University of America, and Dan Barker, the founder of the Freedom From Religion Foundation. Our moderator will be Dr. Don Critchlow, the director of the Center for Political Thought and Leadership here at ASU. So thank you all again very much for coming, and enjoy the debate.
Gee, I didn't know I could get so turned on with an audience. Where the debate is formatted this way: each speaker has 10 minutes, and then we're going to then they have a 2-minute rebuttal, and then we're going to take questions from the audience. The cards are in front of you, so if you have a question that you think of during the debate, just raise your hand and a person will come by and pick those up. We're also going to ask you, all of you, if you will, to fill out the card. Just leave it on your table with your name and email address, and that way we can inform you of future events. I think the speakers don't need any further introduction. The first speaker will be Dan, and he will be followed afterwards with 10 minutes each. Please.
Thank you, Dr. Critchlow. Thank you, Rachel. Thank you, Richard. Thank all of you for coming. I see a lot of friendly, radical, non-believing faces out there, and some believers out here as well. I used to be a preacher, and you saw that the format tonight is 10 minutes for opening. You're going to see a miracle tonight. A former preacher talk for 10 minutes. Can you believe it? Religion is bad for America. There's a lot of ways to define religion, but I think most of us understand religion to be a system of belief and or practice that asserts that there's some kind of a transcendent realm out there with at least one being in it that we relate to in some way or another. That's not a problem, that's just a metaphysical position. The problem is faith. Faith is not only not a valid way to learn about the world, nor is it a realistic guide for living, but faith in the unprovable, incoherent, unreliable, primitive, supernatural, and superstitious words of so-called holy books, like the Bible or the Quran, has caused immeasurable harm in the world. Easter morning in 2008, 11-year-old girl named Kara Newman didn't go to church. She had this long brown hair that she liked to wear in a ponytail, and she was very artistic. She was sick. Her parents believed the Bible. They had faith in the Word of God that says, all things whatsoever ye shall ask for in prayer believing, you shall receive. Is any sick among you? It says in James chapter 5, verse 15, call for the elders of the church to anoint them with oil, and prayer of faith will heal the sick. Her believing parents prayed for her. They brought in the elders. She died a horrible, agonizing, screaming death of undiagnosed but easily treatable diabetes. Her parents believed the Bible when the Bible was not telling the truth. She died a victim, a martyr to her parents' faith. And hundreds of kids around the country die each year, a lot, usually like Christian Scientists or Jehovah's Witness kids, as a result of this faith in this holy book, in this false holy book. I'm going to give you a list of horribles, obviously. That's my job tonight. Is religion bad for America? I could talk for 2 or 3 hours about it, and I'm just going to have to limit it to some of them and then go from there. But a list of the harm committed by religious people, often in the name of religion. America, what do we mean by America? Think about the American Indians who lived here for thousands of years, 12,000 to 15,000 years, which is actually 9,000 years before the world was created, if you're a young earth creationist, raising their families in that, and yet the Christian Europeans came over here. Jamestown massacred a bunch of them. The Massachusetts Bay Colony, in the name of God, to establish the city, holy city on the hill, killed the Pequots to get them out of the way so that God's people could people this planet and this continent. How many of you think that was good for America? The Spanish missionaries who went up the California coast building these missions, conscripting the slave labor of the Indian tribes that were there, and eventually ending up in a genocide, all to promote the faith of the one true church. What a loss to America. What a horrible loss that those tribes don't exist anymore because of the arrogance of Bible-believing Christians. Maybe it was good for white Christians, but it was not good for America. Slavery, think about slavery. The Bible is a very pro-slavery book. In fact, sermons in the South before and during the Civil War were quoting the Bible to support that horrible institution of owning human beings. Even Jesus demonstrated his compassion by telling us, you know, there are some slaves you should not beat as hard as others because they didn't know better. Christianity is a very pro-slavery book. The Ku Klux Klan to this day sings, "Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war." That is bad for America. The harm of religion to women and women's rights. Elizabeth Cady Stanton, the atheist who campaigned for this radical idea that women should be able to participate in their own democracy for suffrage. She was fought by the church. The church says women should keep silent. Women are secondary. It's Eve's fault that there's sin in the world. Women have had to fight the Bible. Even Elizabeth Cady Stanton and her friend Susan B. Anthony were always fighting the church and religion. That was bad. The church has consistently, I shouldn't say the church, I should say a lot of religious people, because there were liberal believers, there were Quakers and others who joined in abolition, but religion has a huge tradition of opposing progress. For example, gay rights. Right now, there are people who think there's something wrong with being gay, and they're using their religion to fight real progress in this country, and they're losing that fight. They always lose the fight. They hate losing, but they're going to lose that fight as well. Birth control, the individual liberty of women to control their own reproductive future, climate change, disregard for the environment, stem cell research, they're fighting that because they think stem cells are human beings and it's killing a human being. Bill Maher gave a hilarious monologue where he says, you can't compare a stem cell to a baby. Stem cells you can freeze indefinitely, which is something you can't do with a baby, right? It's not the same thing. It's sort of a blinkered, absolutistic religious mentality that tries to stop real progress, progress of death with dignity and doctor-assisted suicide. And of course, the issue of these priests and ministers who are molesting children and the church covering all of that up and the billions of dollars that are going not to help the victims, but to help the church cover up its own image. The sexual scandal cover-up within religion, endorsed by the religion because of this unequal hierarchy of a clergy that they call father who controls their lives. Was 9/11 good for America? That was religion. 9/11 was religiously motivated. That was bad for America. There were massacres here. There were the Mountain Meadows Massacre in Utah where the Mormons killed an innocent party of people and stole all their belongings with the acknowledgement and the approval of Brigham Young. Religiously motivated violence in this country. Religious hospitals. You think hospitals are giving great charity. Religious hospitals don't give much. They give less charity, actually, than secular hospitals, and many of them refuse to perform sterilizations that are needed or requested or to offer birth control or to honor the end-of-life directives of patients. That is bad for America. In fact, the Catholic Charities, the Archdiocese in Washington, D.C., is now refusing to continue its social services, which includes feeding the homeless, in protest of the passage of the same-sex marriage bill in the district. Their doctrine is more important than helping real people. Religion is harming the progress. Catholic Charities in Illinois were helping the state place orphans with adoptive parents. But when the state of Illinois recognized civil unions, the state told Catholic Charities, you can't refuse to place in gay families. So what did the Catholic Charities do? They shut down the whole program. They denied adoption to 350 young people. Why? Because their doctrine, their religious ideas were more important than helping real people. Of course, religion is also a threat to education. When you teach these obviously erroneous ideas about the age of the earth or oppose the fact of evolution, and so on. I could make a huge list, and you know I could go on for hours and hours of a list of horribles, right? You could add a lot to the list. What is our debate going to be about tonight, basically? Jay, I'm sure, could come up with a huge list of great things, good things that religious people have done. And you know what? I agree with him. Most religious people are good people. Most Christians are good. They're compassionate, they're charitable, they're sacrificial, they help. Most religious people are like that, but you could say the same thing about atheists. Atheists build hospitals. Atheists are charitable and sacrificial. Religion cannot take the credit for actions that we all do. All religions talk about peace. Surprise, surprise. This religion talks about peace and love and joy and hope. All of them talk about that. Even we atheists talk about that. Those are not religious values. Religion cannot take the credit for something that we all do. Those are human values. They transcend religion. Talk about transcendence. Human values transcend religious values. What makes those values good is their humanism, not their theology. This means that the purely religious values, if you separate, like C.S. Lewis tried to do, a mere Christianity, if you take mere morality and separate out our common human goodness, What you are left with is these religious teachings that make one religion different from another, or supposedly better than another. Those are not good values. What day of the week you should worship? How many times should you say a certain prayer? What religious texts should you admire? What words can you say, or pictures you can draw, or songs you can sing? Or what books or music or movies are allowed, or what food you can eat, or whether you can drink alcohol, or in Utah, caffeine. Or whether women can take positions of leadership, or how women should submit to men, or how women can control their own reproductive future, or who your children are allowed to date or to marry, or how gays or infidels should be dealt with, or how a special class of privileged people called the clergy should be addressed, or whether they should be married or not. Oh, yes, well, I'm basically done. So those purely religious things that separate one religion from another are divisive. They are an unnecessary source of religious conflict. We don't need religion to be good. Our country would be much better off without that unnecessary social conflict.
I thought he was going to give me a warning.
A warning? No, he didn't give him a warning. Maybe give me a warning. Yeah, give me a warning. Well, it's great to be here tonight. Thank you all for coming out. I always love coming to Arizona. Everything looks different in Arizona. Everybody looks much, much sunnier and happier and tanner than I was in Seattle until recently, and now I live in D.C., so I just love coming down here. Thanks for coming out. Well, of course, the proposition we're debating is stated in a way that Dan has to sort of defend the positive, that is, that religion is bad for America. So a Weasley philosophical way of responding in my case would be to just say, religion is not bad for America, right? That would be the sort of the negative side of his claim. But that doesn't seem like a sporting thing to do. So what I want to argue is in a specific way that religion is good for America. But religion by itself is a very vague thing. As Dan said, he gave a sort of vague definition that I would basically agree with. But in the United States, we all know that the predominant religion, both historically and even demographically in 2015, is Christianity. Something like about 75% of the population self-identifies as Christian. And so I don't think if we were in Riyadh in debating this question, it would be an entirely different debate, I think, and we'd probably be on the same side of it. But religions do teach different things. They don't all actually teach the same thing. They have different social consequences. You can judge people based on their actions differently depending on the religious beliefs that they profess. And so I would say the way to sort of frame this, and the thing I would defend, is that the primary religion that has shaped the United States historically and that is the majority religious beliefs of Americans is good for America, but not good in some vague sense, because you always want to know good in comparison to what. If we're comparing it something to some unrealizable utopia, there's actually nothing that's good, right? Compared to an unrealizable utopia, anything on this side of the kingdom of God is going to be bad. So the question is Christianity better than the live alternative, and the alternative that Dan would propose, which would be something like secularism or irreligion or materialism. So I would argue that Christianity is good for America, and in fact that it's better for America than the live alternative. Let me give you just a couple of obvious examples, some Dan has already talked about. He talked about atheists and secular hospitals and things like that, but just sort of put that in the back of your head. How many atheist societies do you know of? How many hospitals do you actually know of that are started by atheist societies, and named by atheists? ASU students, do you know what the closest hospital to ASU is? It's St. Luke's. Yeah, as it turns out, the American hospital system, I didn't actually know this stuff, I had to look it up. The current U.S. healthcare system is in large part the outgrowth of healthcare institutions founded by Catholic sisters. That's the historical origin. These things I'm telling you actually aren't especially controversial. 642 hospitals and 1,600 continuing care facilities in all 50 states of the United States. One out of six patients in the United States is cared for by a Catholic hospital or care institution. That's just the Catholic, so that doesn't count all the Protestant and other religious organizations. Overwhelmingly, They are the ones that started hospitals. We don't have secular hospitals, we have state hospitals. But of course, it's just because something is established by the state, that's the people. And so the people itself, we'd have to sort of divide the demographics of the people. To be able to call a state hospital a secular hospital, it'd have to be established by a state that's overwhelmingly secular. So there really are very few examples you can think of, literally, of atheist or secular hospitals. How about colleges? 106 of the first 108 colleges in the United States were founded by religious groups, but most by explicitly Christian organizations. By 1860, there were 246 colleges in the United States. 17 were state colleges. Almost every other one was founded by a Christian denomination. Now, that might surprise you, right? Because, of course, what leads to the foundation of an institution and where it ends up are two different things. So many of those places, many of those colleges, one that I attended, don't retain their Christian identity. But that's a very important distinction that I want you to keep in mind. There's a question of what is it that can give a people an impetus to do something, and then what happens to institutions over time? Those are two very, very different things, and that's why we need a historical perspective on this question to actually truly and objectively assess the role and the contributions of the Christian religion in American history. One-room schoolhouses started out all over the country. These were essentially Protestant day schools. This, much to the consternation of Catholics when they came over from Italy and Ireland, they discovered all the public schools, they weren't secular schools, they were actually Protestant schools. This is what led to the parochial school system among Catholics, is that they'd go to the school and say, gosh, this is basically a Catholic education. But that's who started the schools. Now, there's a complicated story I could get into about how those became state schools. But the question is, there's a difference between where something ends up and who actually founds it. That's a contribution of Christianity. Charity. Social science surveys overwhelmingly show that religious people, in the United States, that primarily means Christians and Jews, give large amounts and much larger amounts to charity and to charitable causes than non-religious people. Now, I don't know why, but that's a sort of statistical fact. Social and psychological benefits to religious belief and practice. Studies show that Americans who are actively religious are less likely to commit crime and domestic abuse, are less likely to abuse drugs and alcohol, are healthier, live longer, and attain more education than those who are not religious. Does that mean there aren't religious people that do terrible things? Of course not. Of course not. But we judge an idea and we judge a religion by its key identifiers, by its best representatives, not its worst representatives. That's the point. And so statistically, we know that if you're religious, you're more likely to be happy and healthy and less likely to commit crime. That's a statistical fact. But I actually think all of this stuff is kind of trivial. I actually think the important contributions of Christianity are subterranean, and they're very difficult for us to notice because we have inherited it. It's the sort of psychological and philosophical structure in which we think about things. It's the ideas that we have inherited, the ideas of moral truth, the idea that we ought to be kind to gay people, the idea that human beings, regardless of their creed or the color of their skin or their competence, should enjoy intrinsic value and dignity. This idea didn't just come from anywhere. This didn't just drop out of the sky. It didn't just sort of spring up from Zeus's head. This came from a very specific Christian idea working its way historically over many centuries into particular cultures, never perfectly implemented, but very specifically Christian. So here's some broad cultural influences that Christianity gave us that I would argue secularism and atheism are very unlikely to deliver. First, just the idea of moral truth. The question's not whether atheists know right from wrong. Of course they do. All of us in this room know that it's wrong to torture small children for the fun of it. We know that. I know it. I'm a Christian. If you're an atheist, you know it as well. The question is, in what metaphysical framework do moral truths make sense? In a materialistic framework, moral truths, it turns out, are very problematic. You don't need to believe me. Look at the best representatives of the atheist case. Don't trust me. Michael Ruse and E.O. Wilson. These are intellectual giants among Darwinists and materialists. This is what they tell us about morality. Not that atheists can't believe something's right or wrong, but this. Our belief in morality is merely an adaptation put in place to further our reproductive ends. That's what they go on to say. In an important sense, ethics as we understand it is an illusion fobbed off on us by our genes to get us to cooperate. It is without external grounding, Ethics is illusory in as much as it persuades us that it has an objective reference. Now, I have, unlike Dan, I've not found a sort of fringe character. This is a representative explanation from leading atheist intellectuals about what morality is. It has no objective reference. It is an illusion fobbed off on us by our genes. But that's not explaining our conviction of moral truth. That's explaining away our conviction of moral truth. Again, this is a sort of representative sample. The ideas I mentioned briefly a minute ago of individual human rights. Even Thomas Jefferson, probably one of the least religious of our founders, when he went to write the Declaration of Independence, and he talked about our inalienable rights, he framed them in explicitly theological terms. And you can do a graduate school education studying the concept of human rights, and you will have a very hard time accounting for it philosophically without a frankly theological conviction that people have an intrinsic value and dignity because they're creatures made in the image of God. It's not an empirical truth. In fact, look around. None of us are equal in any sort of obvious empirical way. Some of us are tall, some are short, some are smart, some not so smart, some nice, not so nice. Right? How do you ultimately come to this conclusion? Most cultures in most of human history simply didn't believe it. The two of the three sort of streams of Western tradition, Greece and Rome, denied the idea of human equality. It was only the Judeo-Christian strand that gave rise to that idea. So even the objections that Dan raises to certain things that Christians have done, when he does that, he's appealing essentially to a Christian theological category in order to do it. Reason. Dan spoke about the importance of reason rather than faith. It turns out reason's highly problematic, also in an atheist view. And with that, I'll stop. Thank you very much.
We have a two-minute reply by each person.
I think the final one is three.
Oh, okay.
So these two, so we have two minutes and then a final statement that's three.
Okay. The we're negotiating here.
Let's just look and see what okay. The list is. So these are we each have two minutes.
Yeah, two minutes, okay. And Dan goes first, I think.
That's funny that you would say human dignity and human rights originate from Christianity, because you do not find that in the Bible. Nowhere in the Bible do you find an acknowledgement that human beings deserve to be treated with fairness or respect. In the Bible, human beings are worms, they are sinners, they are to be enslaved. You don't find, the only equality you find in there is for baptized Christians. The values you're talking about are Enlightenment values, not Christian values. Christianity puts down humanity. It does not elevate humanity. These studies that you quote, most of them are self-reported studies. If you ask a Mormon, does your religion make you happier? Oh, yes. It'd be like asking a drunk person, how happy are you? Of course, they're going to say they're happy, right? There haven't been any really true evidence-based empirical studies that show that what people say is actually true. In fact, if you look at the happiest countries in the world, like Denmark, the countries that are the most successful are the least religious. About 4% of the Danes say they believe in a God. Yet by any social measure of happiness and success, the Swedes and a lot of the Europeans are much happier people than those who profess to be Christian. So these statistics that Jay quotes have been countered, especially by a born-again Christian himself, George Barna, who shows that born-again Christians have a higher divorce rate. They take just as many drugs for depression. They don't have better lives when they actually report to another born-again Christian. So hospitals, do I have time to talk about hospitals here? I'll save that for the second part of it, the hospital part. Well, Catholic hospitals that you mentioned receive almost 50% of their funding from me and you, from the taxpayer. They got about $25 billion in funding, and they deny health care. In fact, religious hospitals usually write off about 2.5% of their health care for charity. Non-religious and secular hospitals write off about 5.5%. You're much more likely to get true charity in a non-religious hospital. The the Catholic hospitals, the religion's getting the credit, but we taxpayers are getting the bill.
Well, he did, but it's like halfway through, so it's tough. Yeah. Well, just three sort of brief things. There's a difference between a straw man and what I call an Iron Man argument. A straw man, you all know what this is. Any ASU students are going to know what this is. A straw man argument is in which you take the weakest form of the idea that you're trying to defeat or you're critiquing, and you defeat that. Now, just ask yourself, I don't want to answer this question. Answer it for yourself. Has Dan given a straw man or an Iron Man argument on behalf of Christianity? Has he chosen the strongest examples, the best representatives of the Christian faith, or the weakest? We all know there are pathological manifestations of religion, and there's pathological manifestations of political ideology. But I wouldn't judge atheism based on the craziest atheist I know, right? That's not the way to handle it. We all know that Mother Teresa and William Wilberforce and St. Francis of Assisi are better representatives of the Christian faith. We know they're more Christ-like, they're more Christian than the Westboro Baptist Church, for instance, or the Ku Klux Klan, if we want to sort of somehow call that a part of Christianity. So Iron Man rather than straw man arguments. There's a crucial distinction and a confusion I think Dan is making in his comments, and it's confusing in spite of with because of. Lots of bad things have happened in spite of Christianity, and there are things like this that happen everywhere. Slavery, for instance, was a universal human institution. The question is, in what culture was slavery abolished? Finally, after thousands of years, it was abolished in one place, and it was abolished for specifically theological reasons. We should expect, because slavery is a universal institution, that there would be Christians rationalizing slavery. Nevertheless, the key philosophical and moral motivation for the abolition of slavery was Christianity. And then finally, just a question, this sense of where things start and where they end, something that we can sort of call parasitic atheism. There are lots of ideas and institutions started and rooted in the Christian faith that lose their way and that become intuitive and obvious to secular and non-religious people as well. We should all be thankful that we all have moral intuitions that we might call liberal. We should be thankful that every one of us in this room actually believes that intrinsic dignity of the human individual and equality are real things. But there's another question where it came from. Thank you.
Thank you. The Enlightenment happened in spite of, not because of, Christianity. In Europe, that's where basically we talk about the Enlightenment happening. Christianity was the dominant culture, so it looks kind of like it came out of Christianity. It came out of, in spite of it. My point that I was trying to make, which Jay has not responded to, is that these values that he is promoting, which are good values, are not biblical values. The Bible does not promote those things. You should connect the dots. If you think those Christian values that we live by are from the Bible, then make that case. You can't make that case, because in the Bible, you do not find that. You find basically a huge put down of humanity. You don't find any acknowledgement that we all have individual liberties and that, you know, in the Bible, in fact, says you should bring into captivity every thought under the obedience of Christ. If you take the prison population of America, you know how atheists are represented? Can you guess? It's not 2%, it's not 0.2%, it's not 0.02% of the prison population are atheistic. Most people committing crimes believe in a God. I don't happen to agree with Ruse about morality, but even if I did, that wouldn't make the Christian system any better. Christians are basically borrowing from humanistic, basic, evolved values that we all share among ourselves. In fact, Jay talked about how can we judge a religion to be good or bad? You can only do that if there's something that transcends the religion, and that, as I'm talking about, is human value, not religious value. Religious value gets in the way. Religious value is divisive. Look at the social conflict that has come from it. Schoolhouses were often used for the forced conversion of my Native American ancestors into a civilized The religion of the Europeans who came over here with a Bible in one hand and a gun in another to forcibly convert through the arrogance that their worldview somehow was superior or, as Jay says, better. Our debate is not what is better or not. Our debate is about religion itself. Is religion good or bad? And if you look at the practice, the general overall practice of religion, and separate out the mere morality from it, which we all share, and atheists have built hospitals. In fact, the University Hospital in London was constructed precisely because the religious hospitals were discriminating. They were giving preference to people of their own denomination. And people like Jeremy Bentham, who was an atheist, says, we should have a hospital that is truly for all the people and stop this religious divisiveness and smallness of preference from one religion to another.
So I've argued that Christianity is good for America. Dan has argued essentially that it's bad, very, very bad. But this is the question I want to leave you with. Virtue is difficult. Vice is easy. Virtue requires habituation and fighting against our natural tendencies. That's why things like degradation and slavery is a universal institution. We in this room share particular moral values, but they're quite peculiar and eccentric if you take the broad historical view. So we still have to ask ourselves the question, and it's a straightforward historical question, where they came from. Now, if I had a bunch of time, I'd actually make a biblical and theological case for human dignity, but I don't actually think this is an especially complex or controversial point. It's widely recognized by many atheists that the idea of intrinsic dignity and equality emerges from Judeo-Christian soil. That is the root of that idea. But because of the fact that virtue is hard and vice is easy, because we have the natural tendency as fallen creatures to hate rather than to love, that's why humane institutions just barely emerged in the West, just barely emerged in a culture that had been taught for centuries over and over that God made human beings male and female, that we all share a common origin. And having been taught that and constantly contradicting it, nevertheless, a particular experiment in the United States in which those who profess that belief, such as Thomas Jefferson, did not implement it consistently, managed, finally, if imperfectly, to implement the idea. But it only happened just barely. And so the question is religion or irreligion better for habituating us in the virtues that we know we need? Thank you very much.
Well, I ask the debaters, and isn't this great to see at a university, this kind of debate? We're enjoying it, I think. Well, I ask the participants two questions. Why don't we begin to collect questions from the audience? I could see some people writing their questions down. So if you raise your hand, we'll come and collect those. You could use this mic here, and I'll stand. The first question I have is that our founding fathers, overwhelmingly, with some exceptions, James Madison and Thomas Jefferson, believed that religion was central to a well-ordered society and central to the survival of republic. And most of the founders, as Philip Hamburger, a legal historian at Columbia University, showed that they did not believe in the high separation of high walls separating the church and the state. Tocqueville later talked about the importance of religion. So my question is, were the founders wrong or right?
There it is. All right. It's a great question, and the truth of the matter is the founders were somewhat diverse, but I would say if we're going to sort of distill what they held in common, it would be something like this, that almost without exception, they absolutely did not believe in the establishment of a national religion. Though at the time of the founding, of course, the states all had established religion. It was quite clear they didn't want the federal government they didn't want an established national religion, nor did they want the federal government to prohibit the free exercise of religion. That's sort of the point, right? And also without exception, they believed the virtues that come from religion were essential to the American experiment. And so that's the 1-2 part. It's balancing those two sides that I think best captures the general founder's vision. Just a couple of I think, entirely representative quotes. John Adams, "We have no government armed with power capable of contending with human passions, unbridled by morality and religion. Our Constitution was made only for a moral and religious people. It is wholly inadequate to the government of any other." I think that's a very much a representative statement of what the founders thought, that you can have a secular public square in the sense that the state doesn't have an established religion, but a public square in civil society that's deeply religious and that is, in fact, essential to the prospering of the political experiment. That's how I'd understand it.
Thank you. You're right to say the founders were diverse. Many of them were devout believers. Many of them were churchgoers. But we should judge them by what they did. They disagreed with each other. In fact, when you talk about the founders, what are you talking about? I mean, you could make 40 different groups of who you might consider to be the founders. But I think the founders of our country are the people who came up with the governing document of our country, the men who were at the Constitutional Convention, who founded our country. And regardless of what they believed, they wrote, and they debated this, they wrote a godless constitution. They talked about putting God in, but they decided not to. There was no prayer said at the Constitutional Convention. Even though Benjamin Franklin made an impassioned appeal to have prayer, they declined to have formal prayer at the Constitutional Convention. There was no discussion of the Ten Commandments. There was no discussion of the Bible. None of that came into their discussions in the formation of our governing document. In fact, our very first Congress signed that treaty with Tripoli, which you know about, which said very clearly the United States of America is not in any sense founded on the Christian religion. That was written under Washington, but then signed under Adams. What part of the phrase, in any sense, don't we understand? Our founders had personal religious views. Some of them were very devout, but none of them thought the rest of us should become carbon copies of their views. Yes, some of them were deists, and some of them were, you know, Unitarians or the pre-Darwinian freethinkers of their age. But what they bequeathed to us was a totally secular constitution, a governing document whose only references to religion are exclusionary. There shall be no religious test for public office. The only oath of office is totally secular. And then, of course, the First Amendment, which puts limitations on the power of the government to get involved with religion.
Do we have the questions? And I just want to make sure. And then you get a 2-minute response to on the same question. Is that correct? Okay. Okay. Good. The second question I have is this. For the last 50 years, we've been talking about the breakdown of the family and single parenting, and it's what appears to be a correlation between the breakdown of the American family, crime, lack of education, incarceration, drug use, and so forth. So the question is, as we've become a more secular country, which we have, in terms of people's identification, have we gotten better or we've gotten worse off? If we don't have religion of some sort, what kind of morality will replace it?
I would say I'm a Catholic, and so I think that there are moral truths that can be known by reason apart from revelation. In fact, that's the traditional Christian view. This is what Paul says in Romans 1, that people have the law written on their hearts. The problem is that the natural law, though it's in principle knowable by reason, it's sort of like calculus or geometry. In principle, you could figure out Euclid, right? You could discover calculus. Leibniz did it, and Newton did it. But these were geniuses. How many of us are Euclid, Leibniz, and Newton? That's what the natural law is like. The reality is that people that develop virtues develop them for specific reasons, usually in the context of a family in a very specific religion in which they've been inculcated and in which those people have freely chosen to habituate those virtues. We don't have sort of virtues from our mother's womb. And so the question is whether Christianity, broadly construed in the sense of mere Christianity, or the absence of it is better fit to teach us to be kind and compassionate and loving and forgiving toward each other. That's the key question, not whether they're bad Christians or bad atheists. Which of these socially, because we're talking about religion and society, is more fit for inculcating people in virtue?
And I think Jay pretty much described the basic problem with Christianity and morality. He assumes a pessimistic view of human nature. He said, virtue is difficult and vice is easy. I think it's the other way around. Yes, we do inherit virtue from our mothers. Yes, we do inherit altruism and empathy. We have evolved these traits. Human nature is neither bad nor good. If you want to make a case for original sin, I could make just as much a case for original good. When you see some horrible headline of some, imagine something some mother did to her child. What a horrible thing in the headlines. What's your first thought? What an inhuman thing to do. We assume that basic human nature is good, nurturing, caring, and giving. Of course, we have violent tendencies as well. We have these instincts that Jefferson talked about. How do we have these nurturing instincts unless it came to us from, he thought it was the deistic God who gave it to us. So I think you've got it totally upside down. You are just assuming, you're swallowing the lie from the church that there's something wrong with humanity. I think virtue is very, very easy. Unless you have a bad view of your own human nature, do you feel like running out and raping and killing and stealing? Is that what you really feel like doing? Or don't you naturally feel like holding the door open for a person and giving and being charitable? We are charitable, naturally evolved human beings. Yeah, there's problems, and so we build prisons and we have laws to protect from the tail end of people who are, you know, pathological, the sociopaths or the psychopaths. There are some of those. But those crimes that you were talking about, and those vices, are being committed by religious people, by churchgoers, by people who believe in God. The prisons are packed with people who believe in God. So it's totally upside down and totally backwards. And the only real moral system, and I write about this in my new book, called it's called Mere Morality, is an evolved morality which takes into account our instincts, our social laws, and our reasoning ability to pick the path that results in the least amount of real harm in the natural world. Not following rules, not pleasing the father or obeying a dictator, but looking at the real world, at the consequences that are there. Religion can't do that. Christianity does not do that. It just gives you rules. But humanistic reason can actually do that and think through how to be a good and moral person without religion.
We have quite a few questions from both sides of the aisle. If I could read the handwriting, there was one I wanted to start off with that I thought was quite good. I have to look for it later. I thought I had sorted them. In today's day and age, is it necessary to use and rely on a book written by men, that is, I presume, the Bible, long past to hold power and sway in our present moral strength and development as a whole? I guess the question is the Bible, written, because it was written in the past, still worth reading, and should we follow it? Do you want to flip a coin?
Can you restate the question? I'm not quite sure what the question is. Should we still read the Bible, or
the question is whether we should base our morality on a book written thousands of years ago. And so is that relevant today in this modern age?
I don't think that sort of age of an idea determines whether it's relevant or not. I mean, I wouldn't argue that a sort of isolated religious book by itself, completely out of context, would be either sort of good or bad. I think that scripture, I'm a Christian, and so I have particular confessional beliefs about it, but that's a sort of different question from the debate is about whether religion is good or not, not whether, say, the Bible is true or not. I do think, and I think anyone that sort of studies this seriously and historically will see this is not a Christian argument. I can cite sort of materialists and atheists that admit and in fact defend the idea that most of our humane values that we have in the West came from an essentially Judeo-Christian cast of mind. If there were this sort of generic humanistic idea that were easily apparent, we could determine that empirically. We'd see it historically. We'd see it in lots of different cultures. What there is a general sense of morality. So all the major religions have something about the golden rule, something about thou shalt not kill, and those sorts of things. But they're very specific ideas, I think, intrinsic to the biblical faith that clarify the teachings of the natural law in the same way that a very good calculus teacher clarifies the calculus that in principle you might have discovered like Leibniz or Newton, but that you probably would not have done otherwise.
Do I respond to that? Okay. Any one of us could have come up with a better moral system than the Bible. Any one of us could have. The teachings of Jesus were morally inferior. The things he taught, we wouldn't want to live in the same neighborhood with this person because, you know, he talked about owning and beating slaves. If you read the Bible for what it really says, I'm not cherry picking the bad things. All we need to prove this point is to point out, take any social issue, any moral issue that the country's struggling with right now, you name it, what are they? The war, or stem cell research, or abortion rights, or what else? Birth control, climate change, what else? Yeah, so take all of these issues, right? You will find devout, church-going, Bible-believing Christians who read the same book on both sides of those issues. There's no clarity. There's no moral guidance from the Bible. We all know it's situational. If there were, then they would all agree. Paul even told the believers in 1 Corinthians, the first chapter, he said, let there be no divisions among you. Paul said, God is not the author of confusion. But can you think of a single book that's caused more confusion than the Bible? It's not there. You're pretending that there's moral guidance from that book. It's not there. People pick and choose. And obviously, you think you have the right interpretation, but there have been holy wars fought over those right interpretations. The Bible it has some peppered little advice in it. The golden rule is not so bad. I would call it a bronze rule. It was predated Christianity. It's not a bad idea, but are we so stupid that it never would have dawned on us that there's something wrong with killing without the Bible telling us that? We are smart. We're figuring it out. We're doing a better job than the ancient primitive Bible did in teaching us how to live a good moral life.
This question is to you, Dan, and we can give quick answers, I think, to both. This is only for you, but perhaps we could change it to include you, too, so you're not excluded. But Dan, what happened that caused you to change your mind about faith?
Well, I wrote a whole book about it. It's called Godless, How an Evangelical Preacher Became One of America's Leading Atheists. And Richard Dawkins wrote the foreword to it, and he said in there, Dan wasn't just a preacher. He was the kind of preacher you would not want to sit next to on a bus, you know? That was me. I was the true believer. I really believe in it, and I've dedicated 19 years of my life to promoting that gospel, which I loved. And I think most of the Christians I met and dealt with back then were really good people. It was really hard to change. Imagine yourself changing your worldview. So I can't tell you the whole story in 60 seconds, but basically I learned that Christianity is not true. The moral question was secondary to me. Christianity is also not moral. But the most important question you should ask of any religion is it true? Did Jesus really rise from the dead? You know, what are the probabilities of his own existence? What about, how did the book come to be written? So, and the moral issue is also important, but for me, I just wanted to know if it's true or false. And I learned painfully that it's just not true. It took about 4 or 5 years. I went across the whole Christian spectrum from fundamentalist to more moderate to more liberal. And what I say is I dumped out all the bathwater and I found out, hey, there's no baby there. It's just, there's nothing there. It's pretense. It's delusion. And Jay, if you really think this being exists, you're deluding yourself. You're playing this cultural game that has been imposed on you. It's not there. There's a better way.
Well, I hope you weren't totally convincing because we want to give him a chance to argue with you. Otherwise, we could call it evening and go home and eat. It'd be gradual, okay.
Oh, my faith, okay. I can't answer Dan's question about it, why he ceased to be a Christian. I actually was raised in a very conventional Presbyterian church in Amarillo, Texas, and more or less lost my faith my freshman year in college, what little faith I had. Someone had given me a little six-pack of books by C.S. Lewis. I don't know who gave them to me, actually. And so I actually decided, I said, well, you know, I've taken this sort of faith thing for granted. I recited the Apostles' Creed. I don't know that it's actually true. Lewis did not answer all the questions for me, but he did persuade me that the case for the Christian faith is intellectually formidable, that it's grounded in history, that it's grounded in moral truth, that it resonates with people across the world, that there's a solid case to be made, for instance, for Christ's resurrection. There's a solid case to be made for the existence of God, that there are all sorts of philosophical conundra that cannot be answered without at least postulating theism or the existence of God. So Lewis didn't solve all those problems for me, but he did persuade me that Christianity was intellectually robust. And my trajectory is essentially the opposite of yours, Dan. The longer I've spent with it, this wasn't imposed on me. In fact, it would not have been difficult probably for me to give it up at one point. My career wasn't committed to it. I became deeply convinced that it was true. And I eventually became Catholic, so that wasn't imposed on me. I did that freely. I don't think Catholics are the only Christians. I think, though, for me, it was a fuller expression of what I had come to believe. Of course, the debate tonight is not about the truth of this, but I'll say something that Dan and I absolutely agree with. I would not say that you ought to adhere to a religion simply because it maybe leads you to do nice things. I think the fundamental question is whether or not it's actually true. And I think truth, goodness, and beauty ultimately come together. But that's the primary question. We're not debating that tonight, but I totally agree.
Why are so, this is another question, why are so many religious groups so focused on managing human sexual behavior? Should we, who wants to go first? Did you hear the question?
No, the reality is that for some weird reason, sexuality is on absolutely everyone's mind. Everyone is fixated on this question of sexuality, not just religious people. Come on, look at the bumper stickers out here. Go to any internet site. Sexuality is sort of central to our attention, whether we're religious or irreligious. I'm actually somewhat perplexed by this. The reason, I think, if I was going to speculate that it's such a controversial question, is that it is a fundamentally important question. Human beings are not just isolated individuals. God created us as social beings. We are born ideally and normatively into families. We're raised and inculcated and loved in that context. We are both individual beings with intrinsic value and dignity as creatures made in the image of God. We're also intrinsically social. And there's particularity to our sociality. And so this question of sexuality, of the complementarity of male and female, the sort of structure and particularity of human nature, is important. And so there's a reason that whether you're a Christian or a Jew or an atheist, sort of recognize the importance of it. I think it's a little odd that this is the thing culturally we've decided to fixate on. But on the other hand, it's not so odd because it involves our intrinsic sociality. And so it's the sort of thing that in a culture we're going to have to debate and we're going to have to argue. I'm thankful that we live in a culture, though, in which you can have a public setting like this. And Dana and I didn't spend any time worrying about getting shot or killed, right? We can still have these debates. And so we should all be thankful that we do live, ultimately, in a generally humane culture in which we can debate these things and debate these questions of sexuality as well.
I think Christianity is fixated with the sexual questions, and that includes gay rights as well, because Christianity inherited the patriarchy of Judaism. And if you read the Old Testament, really, even the God himself, who calls himself a jealous God, and he talks about his people as his bride, who's committing whoredoms and fornications and all, there's a big sexual overtone to the entire Old Testament, if you look at it. I think it all goes back to patriarchy, which was the control of access to females. Females were property. If you look at the Ten Commandments, it's directed at men. You should not covet your neighbor's cattle or wife. It was all about controlling your property, your wife, for inheritance reasons as well. And a lot of the Old Testament stories, if you look at them, have to do Abraham needing an heir, and Lot didn't have Lot's daughters, and they couldn't get married. All the stuff about inheritance and who's going to live on. So I think Christianity inherited this sort of sexual insecure attitudes of the writers of the Old Testament, who were maybe frustrated in some way, but females being devalued is a big part even of the New Testament as well, where Paul even told women to keep silent in the church. So if sexuality is free, what does that do to patriarchy? If women can control their own reproductive future, if women are allowed to think for themselves and choose their own mates and uncover their bodies like in the Abrahamic religion of Islam, well, that's a real threat to the power of macho men over the women that they want to control and own. I think that's what it's all about.
Boy, this is really fun, isn't it? The next question, if religion is true and good, why are there so many of them?
Yeah, there are a heck of a lot of them, aren't there? I actually don't think religion is good and true. I don't think all religions teach the same thing, and none of you do as well. We all know that different religions teach different things. There are commonalities. C.S. Lewis has a wonderful book in which he sort of lays out the commonalities of certain religions, and there's sort of a core set of moral beliefs. But Islam does not teach the same thing as Christianity. I would like to believe that that were true, but it's simply not. He sort of tests this. Of course, every religion has pathological manifestations in members and better representatives. And so I would say to sort of morally assess any religion, you want to assess the best practitioners of it. Assess Mother Teresa or St. Francis of Assisi. Everyone, atheists and Christians, would say, okay, those are good examples. Those are people that are Christ-like. You might not like everything that they do, but that the sort of spirit of Mother Teresa is not the same thing that you're going to get, I would suspect, in an Islam. So I wouldn't say religion itself is good or bad any more than I would say politics is good or bad. I think there are political ideas that are good and political ideas that are bad. Same with religion.
I was going to pass, but you mentioned Mother Teresa. Mother Teresa's genius was as a huge PR machine for the Catholic Church. She did very little real charity. People who have looked at her clinics shows that they were really there to promote her views on abortion, really. People who were shocked that her clinics were really basically just death clinics. There was hardly any real medical care being given. She would give them aspirin. And one of the patients was in pain saying, I'm suffering. And Mother Teresa looked at him and said, well, when you're suffering, that means Jesus is kissing you. Because the poor are meant to suffer. As part of the poor. That's what she said. And then the patient said, well, can you tell him to stop kissing me, please? She was not a good example of a moral, compassionate woman, but the church was really good at marketing her. And look at all these corrupt politicians who paid money to the church so that they get their pictures taken with her to put on their brochures. Mother Teresa did some good, but I think a lot of other Christians, a lot of non-Christians have done just as much, if not more. Beatrice and Sidney Webb in England, she was an atheist who dressed as a poor person to go down and look at the poverty, realizing that England needed a healthcare system. It was atheistic people like them who did more than Mother Teresa to actually establish a system that helps the poor and the needy.
Do you want to respond to that or no? Okay. Well, this is for Dr. J. Richards. Would you please respond to the argument that the Bible does not have equal human rights ideas and similar to as you just described? I think that was written while you were talking. So,
can I use this one? Oh, it's a microphone situation. I just don't understand it. I agree with Dan that there are patriarchal elements in the Old Testament. The question is, again, though, notice the difference. Where did the idea that male and female are equal come from? Where is it taught and not taught? It's right there at the very beginning in Genesis 1. And you don't have to make up your minds about the length of the days of creation. God made man and woman, male and female. That same Paul who you criticized, radically in the first century in the ancient Near East, tells husband and wife to submit to one another. That's a radical and almost insane statement to make at the time. So yes, of course, there are patriarchal elements in Scripture, and we can debate what kinds of patriarchy might be better than others, but the fundamental moral and metaphysical equality of women is explicitly taught on page one of the Bible, and the idea of the equality of men and women comes uniquely from a Judeo-Christian culture that's now articulated clearly by atheists as well as Christians and others.
Just keep it on. That is so totally upside down. Adam was created first. Eve was then pulled out of his rib, if you can figure that out, as a help meet for the man. And she was to be a servant to the man. And in fact, in the New Testament, of course it does. Read your Bible. Read it on page one of your Bible. She was to be a helper to the man. Yes, it was. She was to be after she disobeyed. In fact, I admire Eve for having the independence to want a taste from the fruit of knowledge. Who wouldn't want to do that, right? And yet she was punished, and she was told that her husband would master over her. The New Testament picked up on it because Eve was the one who first sinned, so blame the woman. Christianity is all about blaming the woman and putting down. There's no equality anywhere in the Bible between the sexes. Oh, wait, there is. I'm sorry. There is some equality in the sexes. There's a place in the Old Testament where it says when you invade the Amalekites, you should eat their sons and their daughters.
I can see the audience is getting stirred up while you're talking. It's like a revival. So I'm going to ask people not to applaud during the I think it'd be better though. I do think the next question is for you. We have just a few more, and we want to keep our answers very, very short. This is so much fun, but we want to go to sleep tonight too. I always enjoy that. I think some people want to bring you back to the church, reconvert you, and someone asked, and I'm curious about this too. What denomination did you belong to that you were a preacher of and that you ended up losing your faith? Your religious faith, excuse me.
Yeah, people are always asking that as if that should matter. You know, there's so many denominations and they all disagree with each other and they can all prove to you by opening the Bible that they have the truth. I could do that when I was a minister. I was raised in an evangelical, Bible-believing Christian family. We were in the Nazarene church when I was a young boy, but then we went to a Baptist church for a while. And my parents wanted a true, deep spiritual relationship. When I was 15, I accepted Christ as my personal Savior. I confessed my sins. I accepted his death on the cross as payment for my sin, his resurrection as a promise of eternal life. I was born again. I accepted a call to the ministry. I truly believed it. If I was not a true Christian, nobody is. I truly, truly believed it. My first associate pastor was at a Friends church, which is kind of the modern Quakers. Richard Nixon came out of that tradition. But then I went for a year and a half to an Assembly of God church, which was interesting. They were really sweet and sincere people, but way too noisy for my taste, if you know what I mean. And I'm glad I was there for a while, and I spoke in tongues, and actually I still can as an atheist. I won't do it tonight, but I can still get all those feelings. It's amazing. The religious experience is really an amazing thing if you feel it. And then I was then in an interdenominational Christian church associated with the Disciples of Christ, which is the church that ordained me. And then I went on 8 years of evangelism and as a Christian songwriter. So I kind of represented a kind of cross-section of the evangelical, Bible-believing Christian world.
I didn't realize that answer was going to be so long. I lost track. It's interesting. Three more questions. First of all, why, this is a question on the card, why do you think there's been a decline of religious belief, that presumes that there is in the question, in America?
Yeah, there is a decline. The country is becoming much more secular than it was. In 1990, 7% of Americans checked none for religion. What was their religion? They put none. In 2001, it was over 14%. Today, it's almost 20%. And among the young people, you students here, the 20-somethings to the under 30 crowd, it's about 30 to 33%. That's the hugest it's ever been. Wait till this group starts voting. Right? Students don't vote, but when you start voting, whatever your views are politically, you're going to make a huge difference in the world. But part of it is the fact that I think our country is catching up with Europe. Europe, who had centuries of religious fighting and divisiveness, they realized, wait, this is not good. Most Europeans today are pretty secular. Our country seems to be wanting to catch up. So does Ireland. Ireland and the U.S. were the two outliers as far as religiosity and health goes. Ireland is trying to catch up as well. But another big part of it is the internet. Religion can't hide. You can check it out. You can see that Jesus did not rise from the dead. You can see the arguments for it. You can actually go online. You don't have to take your pastor's word for it. You don't have to take your parents' word for it. Go look it up. Go do some research. It's all there. And I think it's pretty amazing. Today's younger generation are smart. It's a bottom-up kind of excited thinking that the past was old and we've tried religion and it didn't work. Let's do something better.
You must teach at Arizona State University, where all the students are really knowledgeable and quite smart. Which is true mostly. Two last questions. Why does it matter that our ethics stem from biology and not the Holy Book? Why is that less a source of a valid truth, source of truth for moral behavior? That is, I think, a question for both of you. I'm not sure you would base your morality on biology, but that's what the question's asking.
I would argue that we've got a nature, and so I don't actually believe, nor is it the Christian idea, as Dan characterized a few minutes ago, that human beings are worms. Human beings are the greatest things in God's physical creation, the only thing in the universe made in his image, but we are also fallen. That's a completely different thing. Good intrinsically, but fallen. So what's the idea that morality would be based on our biology? There's sort of two aspects to this. One would simply be that it's sort of based on our nature. And so I actually think that's right. I actually think that that's the natural law tradition, that it's a part of our nature. You can sort of assess what's appropriate for the human life, what's appropriate for human flourishing, by assessing what kinds of creatures we are. So I don't actually think the idea that there's a biological component to morality, it doesn't contradict anything, at least in Christian theology. But there's a different idea, and it's the idea that Michael Ruse and E.O. Wilson articulated, and it's the idea that ethics or morality is an illusion fobbed off on us by our genes. Now, what is he talking about? This is basically the idea of saying, is that you might think that you have moral knowledge. You might actually think there are moral truths. For instance, you might think it's actually wrong to torture children for the fun of it. But that's not right. That has no objective reference. Rather, what happened is that ancient human tribes from which we are descended, some thought, well, you know, it's okay to actually torture and eat children, and some thought it's bad to do that. And thinking it's bad to do that provided a selective advantage for those tribes, and we've descended from them. That's the point. So it's actually our moral beliefs, our moral truths, they're illusory. We don't actually have any moral knowledge. It's simply a sort of selective value that we believe this is to be the case. I think that's a morally repugnant idea, and I frankly think if everybody came to believe that it was just an illusion, right, and didn't actually have objective reference, that would have tragic effects on our culture.
Well, atheists are free to disagree with each other, which is part of the benefit of being an atheist. We don't have to follow a creed. I disagree with Ruse. I think he's absolutely wrong. There is solid objective basis for making moral decisions in the real world. And you can sum it up with one word. It's a no-brainer. It's not that hard at all. Morality is not some big capital M mystery that we're trying to figure out. You can sum it up with one word: harm. A moral person is a person who intends to act to minimize real harm in the real world. That's what morality means. There's no objective moral values, because how can you have an objective thing in the mind? To be objective means to exist independent of the mind. So that's like an oxymoron. But you can say that our moral values and decisions are based on the objective reality of what causes more or less harm. Should I do this action or this one? Which results in the least amount of harm? That's objective. It's real. It's not a code. It's not a list. It's not a lookup list of, oh, Jesus, tell me what I should do. I was in the Detroit airport in the late 80s flying to the Phil Donahue show, and the corner of my eye saw this baby kick from a baby carrier, and it was rolling to the floor, and my hand just reached over and grabbed it and stopped it. The mother grabbed it about a second later. She would have been too late. Why did I do that? I wasn't thinking about Jesus or Joseph Smith or Muhammad or how can I show the world that atheists are good people. It was a biological, instinctive thing that happened because, as you point out, those potential ancestors of ours who didn't care about falling babies were less likely to pass their genes down to us. We inherit some basic natural instinctive morality, as Thomas Jefferson pointed out. Why is it that we have this tendency to be good? Why are we good creatures? But instinct alone isn't always that good, because instincts might have evolved in an environment that's different from the one we live in today. So we have reason. We have a frontal lobe that checks our instincts if there's enough time. You can make a solid case for a totally naturalistic moral philosophy that based on nothing transcended or borrowing from somewhere outside the universe, based on the very simple principle of trying to minimize real harm in the real world. It's not always easy in practice, but in principle, that's a very simple concept to understand.
This is the final question. I'm not sure it's the best question of the remaining ones. And I apologize that we didn't get to all of your questions. This has sparked a lot of inquiry from the audience. So I want to thank you. I do want to remind people, though, to please fill out your cards if you want, and leave us your name and your email address. If you don't want to, that's fine. We'll search it on internet and track you down, because this is all recorded. We have your photos and your pictures, so we just want to make it a little easier on you. Last question. Why would both of you be on the same side if this debate was in Riyadh, Saudi Arabia? Would you be on the both sides? I'm not sure. Would you be on the same side? Yes.
Yes, probably so. I mean, there's always the counterfactual question that I think in order to assess whether religion is good for a society, I do think that you don't compare it to an unrealizable ideal. You compare it to the live alternatives. I mean, it's just a sort of basic rule of reasoning. And so you could ask yourself, okay, what's the alternative in the Arabian Peninsula to, in this case, a particular version of Sunni Islam? I think that it is a generally a bad thing. And so I would not argue that religion is good for society, at least the relevant religion in that particular context, if that's what I were arguing in that place.
You agree on this? Okay. Well, maybe we should just conclude. But you have a 2 minute, three minutes, excuse me. I should be in Iran negotiating on this treaty, but this is more fun and easier, I suspect. So who's supposed to go first? So you go first, 3 minutes, followed by another 3 minutes, and then we will give our applause to both of them.
So looking over my notes here, I think I responded basically to every point that Jay made. Doesn't mean it was a good response, but in a debate, you want to try to touch every response of your opponent. Religion is a belief in something that's transcendent, that somehow interacts with our lives and gives us some basis for meaning and purpose in life. You've all heard about Rick Warren's best-selling book, The Purpose-Driven Life. I think he's got it backwards. It's totally upside down and backwards. It's like Jay and I are looking at the same world, but why do we see two different things? Why are we looking at it so differently? What's wrong here? You know, is there something wrong with one of us, or maybe it's that we're looking at the instrument the wrong way? If we both have a telescope, but he's looking at it through the back end, he's going to see something, but he's using it the wrong way. I don't think we have a purpose-driven life. We shouldn't want there to be a purpose-driven life. A purpose-driven life turns us into secondary. It turns us into slaves or followers of something above and beyond ourselves. What we do have is life-driven purpose. We are alive. If there's a God, what is the purpose of his life? Where does he get his moral standards? What is above and beyond him? Doesn't he just get to live? Doesn't he just get to be who he is? We have found ourselves here. You ever seen that silly movie, Pee-wee's Big Adventure, where he's riding the bike, and then he crashes and he falls on the ground, and there's all these kids looking at him, and he gets up and he says, "I meant to do that," you know. We laugh at that because we realize that he's trying to turn an accident into something meaningful. We evolved through a random process. It's not totally accidental, but there's good reasons for natural selection. Here we find ourselves, like with the bike wreck, wondering, and religious people have this tendency to say, "Well, I meant there's a meaning to it," as if meaning from outside was the true meaning that can be delivered to us. The only real meaning is the meaning that you create. You have to be the creator because of your life-driven purpose, the struggles that you fight. If morality is to minimize harm, well, there's a goal. There's a purpose there to have a world with less violence in it, a world with more understanding. Religion compromises that. Religious views get in the way because rather than trying to look at the real world and decide what course of action should I take, you first have to stop and check this list that's totally irrelevant to human morality. If you see someone drowning in a river, what do you do? Oh, I need to look up a list. What thou shalt do when people drown in a river. We all know that it's situational. We all know that we have to use our brains and our reason and our instincts in some cases to try to make this a better world and minimize violence. By nature, I think most of us are originally good people. My mom, who was a Sunday school teacher, in fact, she taught at the Assembly of God Church in Apache Junction here. So they lived there for a long time. She was shocked when her son, the preacher, became an atheist, but she started reading. And eventually, both my mom and dad said, "Yeah, Danny's right. There's no evidence for God. There's no good reason for it. There's no good coherence." She says, "This is great." She told a reporter, "I'm an atheist now, too. This is wonderful. And you know what? I don't have to hate anymore. I can just accept people. I don't have to look at who's the in-group and who's the out-group. I don't have to choose who's the enemy. We're all human beings. We're all in the same species. Jay and I have basically the same instincts and the same concerns about a loving, caring world. We can do a much better job if we strip away the confusing and ambiguous and divisive element called religion in our society."
Sort of difficulty, I think, with resolving this dispute about whether, as I would frame it, whether religion, that is Christianity or secularism or irreligion, is better for society, is that we live in a society, whether you're a believer or an unbeliever, in which our moral intuitions have been tutored by a broadly Judeo-Christian understanding of reality. Where atheism has actually been applied systematically, it's not a pretty picture. What are those societies? We all know, right? The USSR, North Korea, East Germany, Cambodia under Pol Pot. Those are actual applied atheist societies. Am I saying all atheists are communists? No. My point is, all those societies were directly compatible with atheism. When Christians exercise brutality on their human beings, we call them hypocrites, precisely because we understand the difference between what it means to act in a Christ-like manner or a brutal manner. In fact, we already know this. Imagine you're driving in a large city at night, you don't know where you are, your car breaks down in what looks to be a very, very scary neighborhood. Your cell phone's dead, you don't know where you are, so you decide, okay, I'm just gonna walk down this one street that looks promising. Most of the lights are out, you can't see very well, there's nobody around, and then suddenly at the very end of the block, 10 tough-looking teenage boys step out from a building. They start to walk your way, and they're making some kind of racket. You don't know what it is. You think, what, are they chanting? What exactly is going on? Is this like a gang initiation ceremony? What's happening? What is this building that they've walked out of? You try to read the sign on the building. You can't see it. You can't tell what these guys are doing or what they're up to, but they're coming your way. And then just as they get to the position where you can see the whites of their eyes and their faces, and you can just make out the sign of the building they came out of, you realize they're not chanting, they're singing a song. And it's a song you recognize. It's a modern rendition of the hymn by John Newton, Amazing Grace. And now you can see the sign that they've come out of. It says, First Baptist Church, Bible study tonight. Now, what's your response? How do you feel? Do you wish they had come from a bar, a nightclub? Maybe you wish they had come from a lecture by the local atheist group and they had just been told that God doesn't exist, that morality is an illusion fobbed off on us by our genes to get us to cooperate, that we are the product of a blind and purposeless process that does not have us in mind. Do you wish that were the case? Are you offended by this public display of Christian religiosity in this public place? Or are you relieved? We all know the answer. Thank you very much.
I have two questions for you. Was anyone's mind changed tonight? Well, second question, do you enjoy yourself and do you want to thank our two great debaters?
Thank you all for coming and thank you very much both to our speakers. I have these four books to give away. Underneath the desk, there are four pieces of paper that say free book winner. So if you want to look underneath and see if you've won. Okay. If you're a winner, come up and pick one of the books.
I also want to give a thank you to Rachel, who's been such a great help in organizing this event, and also Ben Sanders, the director at Campus Christian Center. He's been such a big help in getting this together. And of course, a big thank you to our speakers and to the moderator.
Yeah, excuse me. The speakers will be here afterwards. You could come up and talk to them. Someone asked who won. I feel like this is kind of a packed convention, but it's interesting to see who was in the audience, perhaps. Who believes the Jay won the debate? Raise your hand if you want. Who believes Dan won the debate? Who believes that nobody won the debate? That's equal, so you it looks like, Dan, you have more friends here, perhaps. You should be running for elected office in Iowa. You could pack the caucus. Thank you very much for coming.